not all pyrethroids come from concrete.
Yes. Good idea. So these, the ones that I'm talking about, probably are not coming from surface runoff. So, a basic outline of what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to talk about the set of objectives that we had when we started our project out at Sacramento Wastewater Treatment Plant. I'm going to give you a brief overview of their system and then a look at how the pyrethroids distribute throughout the plant and how they are distributed in the final effluent. And finally, we're going to look and see if there was a correlation with the toxicity data that was gathered as a portion of the study. So the main objective of the study was first to get a mass balance of the pyrethroids through the treatment plant. We also wanted to look at the distribution in the effluent, basically if they were associated with the particulate phase or the dissolved organic matter or the freely dissolved. We also wanted to fractionate the suspended particulate matter in order to determine if there was a particular size fraction that the pyrethroids were associated with. And we also, at the time, we were hoping to get a correlation with the dissolved concentration with the toxicity data that John Weston was gathering. So this is a complicated diagram of the Sacramento wastewater treatment system. So I'm not sure how familiar all of you are with wastewater treatment plants. So the water comes in here. Sacramento has a secondary system. So they have a primary tank where they settle out a lot of the solids, and then they have a secondary biological treatment where they use an activated sludge system. Then it's chlorinated and dechlorinated and discharged into the Sacramento River. Now the yellow boxes you see along the top, those are places that we collected sample. The influent and the effluent were composite samples, while the interior points were grab samples. Don Weston and Michael Leidy did all of the liquid. I did the solid down here. Also, I did some work on the effluent, but my effluent samples were grab samples, not composite samples, so there is a variation between my numbers and the numbers that Don Weston has. So here, I've simplified the diagram for you. This is the result of the mass balance. It's kind of complicated, but I just really wanted to give you an idea of the scale of the loads going through the treatment plant. So these are all in grams per day. And these are pretty representative of what we saw every time. This just shows one event that we took in November. So you can see permethrin was, of course, the highest, and it was present at every event. And the other three, I think bifenthrin and cyhalothrin were sometimes there, sometimes not there. Cypermethrin was very consistently there, but Don didn't measure it in the effluent. So it was completely removed at each sampling event. So I've also indicated which values were calculated and which values were actually are based on a physical measurement. And right here, I'm showing the amount that was removed by degradation in the carbonation oxidation tank. And I think one of the most, I guess the most surprising piece of this to me was that when you look at the percentage removed here versus how much is actually going into the sludge, that there's more being removed by biodegradation than by being removed by sorption. You can see that better in this diagram that I'm showing here. I've omitted the portion that was removed by grit. This is just an average removal by sorption up to the primary and secondary sludge. And then this bar is the amount that was removed by biodegradation. So I was surprised initially when I saw this, but upon further reading, this is in line with what most other studies have found. Now I'm going to move on to the distribution of the pyrethroid in the effluent. I think Jay's done a lot of work on this, and he's pretty much shown that the dissolved concentration shows the best correlation with toxicity. And usually the technique people use to directly measure the dissolved phase concentration is solid phase microextraction. And the lowest published methyl limit of detection I've seen is around 1 nanogram per liter. That is Jay's number. I don't know if he's gotten it any lower than that. That number was published. And for some of the environmentally relevant concentrations that people are looking at with the new proposed TMDL, are below 1 nanogram per liter. So I'm going to be talking about how we measure the KD of the pyrethroid with the suspended solids in the effluent, and then use that to calculate the freely dissolved concentration. So I think it's instructive to just talk about how I did this, because I think otherwise sometimes people don't really understand what I was trying to do. So as I said, I went out to the treatment plant, collected effluent. Now I did it during the time that the composite sample was collected, but they collected over 24 hours. I was out there for maybe 3 hours. So I collected effluent. I collected three different portions. One portion I brought back to the lab and just did a whole water extraction, got a whole water value for it. The other two, the first one I centrifuged particles greater than 2.6 microns, and the next I centrifuged to remove particles greater than 0.8 microns. And once I centrifuged it, I pipetted out the top and extracted that. The particles were left in the bottom. So once I had the three numbers, I was able to determine how much was associated with the particles by difference. So to determine the KD, I went out and I collected particulate matter with a flow-through centrifuge, and I collected what is operationally defined as particle-free water from the centrifuge supernatant, recombined them, spiked in pyrethroid, allowed it to come to equilibrium. Then I centrifuged it to remove particulate matter because we were seeing particles were sticking to the fiber, so it was inflating the dissolved concentration results. We also took one sample and just did a whole water extraction because there are pyrethroids present in the water already, so I need to know how much there was actually there. Then I measured, after it was centrifuged, I measured with solid phase microextraction to determine what the freely dissolved concentration was. And then I dissolved it in a GC, absorbed it in a GC inlet. If you take this portion of the system, you can determine the KD by the mass balance. I did essentially the same thing for the KDOC, except for I did not add in the particles. I just took the particle-free water, filtered it through a 0.45 micron filter, and did the same process. So these were the results. I presented them in log KOC format. These are the sampling dates along the side, and then the log KDOC is presented on the bottom. The R indicates a rain event. I think most noteworthy, I guess, is that bifenthrin is consistently higher, and that there is some variation within the chemical between the different sampling events. So to try and determine if that was just, what was causing that, we went through and we did correlations with a whole bunch of different, plant, what the operational parameters the plant had at the time that our sampling. We did experimental parameters, was it raining, different things like that. And it turned out that it correlated significantly with the amount of particulate surface area available in the sampling tube. So it appears that these are at least partially surface area driven. So the result is the particle fractionation. So along the side here you see a concentration. That's the whole concentration that was measured, the whole water concentration measure. And then along the bottom, that's the sampling, just the number of the sampling events. The blue represents the whole effluent, the green less than 2.6, and the turquoise less than 0.8. The error bars represent the standard deviation between four replicates. Now, just generally speaking, obviously I had an anomalous sample right there. The blue and the green, there was really no difference between them. So the first centrifugation removed little to no particulate matter or pyrethroid concentration. However, upon the third centrifugation, we did see, in most cases, a statistically significant removal. If you go through and calculate it out, it's around 40% was removed by the third centrifugation. So, what I have done, what this slide shows, is the distribution of the concentration between those four phases. Now, as I mentioned, I showed on the last slide, there's no difference between these two, so I've just basically eliminated that fraction. Here, I've divided the particles up into greater than and less than 0.8 microns. So along this side, you see the whole water concentration. Now, that's a measured value, but the divisions within this, and it's kind of hard to see with these colors, but there's a dark maroon and then an orange. But the divisions within these bars are based on calculations. Now, the phase that I guess we're most concerned with is the red, which is along the top, and that's the dissolved concentration. It was less than 6% in all cases. You can see in bifenthrin, it's consistently smaller than that, and that's really not surprising since it has a larger KD value. Now, I also did a sensitivity analysis on these results. The KDs that I measured were higher than some that have been measured for other environmental solids. So I wanted to see if that significantly affected the calculation. So I changed the KD values to the lowest that I could find in the literature. That did have a big effect on the dissolved concentration. It went from about 6%, the highest, to up to 25% of the total concentration. I also tried the KDOC that I showed. It's a little bit lower than some that are in the literature. When I changed it, it didn't really affect the dissolved concentration that much. Kind of just changed the distribution between the bottom three, or the bottom two, didn't really affect the division between the particles. But it didn't have a great effect on the dissolved. So, I mean, our primary goal when we did this is we wanted to find out if, you know, we could improve the correlation of the pyrethroid concentration with the toxicity. Because Don, for his portion of the study, he from his composite samples, he ran toxicity tests on the samples, and he had measured whole water values as well. So I took his whole water. So this curve just for these points show a log TUs. I show how I've transferred them to TUs at the bottom, and we assumed additivity. And then these are the response that he found he was using dead or paralyzed. I think it's pretty fair to say there's no real correlation here. This is a zero value. The Spearman's rank correlation is basically nothing. So this is what it looks like once I changed it to dissolved. So it basically just shifted it over. So that was disappointing that didn't work. But so in conclusion, it appears that biodegradation appears to be an important mechanism for pyrethroid removal during the treatment, and that wastewater particulate matter appears to have a higher capacity for sorption of pyrethroids than other environmental solids. And the majority of the concentration was sorbed, but only 27% to 40% could be removed by physical processes. And the dissolved concentrate form is less than 6% of the total.